Am I an eligible candidate for a hair transplant? I'm 22 years old. I've been losing my hair since I was 18. I've been taking finasteride consistently for about 2 years now, and I've used minoxidil throughout that time, albeit less consistently. My hair has continued to become progressively thinner despite treatment. I've had significant emotional distress as a result of male pattern baldness, and I'm hoping to get a hair transplant procedure done within the next year.
Thank you for your question. At the age of 22, you have been experiencing hair loss since the age of 18, and you submitted some very good photos to help me understand what your situation is. I understand how emotionally distressed you are, and you're asking a very straightforward question of whether or not you're a candidate for hair transplant and that you want to get something done within the year. Well, to give you an opinion about this scenario, I'm going to share with you first some basic rules and facts that have to be factored in, and I will also introduce you to something that you may not be familiar with that we have been doing in our practice, and we've been truly in a leadership position for several years, called hair regeneration. So let's begin with first the nature of your type of hair loss. Yes, you have what's called male pattern hair loss. And the onset of your male pattern hair loss has been early in your life, and it has been progressing very fast. Now that those two factors are very important in your decision about undergoing transplant. From a pharmaceutical perspective, there are only two drugs that are used and approved for male pattern hair loss. One you're using called minoxidil, which is topical. The other is finasteride. Finasteride is a drug that is used to block an enzyme called 5-alpha reductase, which converts testosterone to dihydrotestosterone. Dihydrotestosterone has been identified as a factor to susceptible hair follicles, which can then become thinner. We call that hair thinning. It's hair that is thinning does not mean that existing hair goes from thick to thinner, but rather during the normal growth cycles, as the hair gets shed, the hair that comes back thinner. So finasteride has been shown to help people with male pattern hair loss reverse that thinning process. But there are some limitations to the use of finasteride that you should also be aware of, and chances are, if you've been doing web research, you already know. From my clinical experience, and I've been prescribing finasteride for patients since 1997-98 when it first was approved, that younger males who have aggressive hair loss typically don't respond as well as males who are in their mid to late 30s who start getting more of a crown, slow progressive expansion of the bald spot area. So even on those medications, people do progress. Second, there is currently a lot of concern about the long-term sexual side effects. And interestingly, in our practice, we have patients who have been taking finasteride for 20 years, and they're fine, or 15 plus years, and they're coming in for prescription renewals, and they've had no problems. And at the same time, we have patients who are coming in who are in their 20s and 30s, who look at the side effects and say there's no way they want to take it. Well, the reason why people are coming to us these days is about this hair regeneration treatment that I'll be discussing in a moment. But to answer the question specifically about hair transplant, when I first trained in hair transplant surgery over 20 years ago, I actually learned from my teachers to avoid doing transplants on younger males like yourself, men in their 20s who are losing hair. And it was because the rate of loss of hair combined with the expected desired result were unfortunately too many variables that weren't going to be in your favor. What does that mean? Well, understand that a hair transplant, and unfortunately in the modern world with aggressive internet advertising and television commercials or infomercials, things are sold and medical procedures are so are over-messaged in a way that you don't even fully understand what the limitations are. You're only shown the benefits, and you're given, and so many very compelling testimonials make you want their product. But understand the facts. The area that you are going to get the hair transplanted from is what we refer to as the permanent zone or the donor area. This is a very limited area. And that limited area in the back of the scalp, in the baldest man you've ever seen, is that bar of hair that won't fall out. And in hair transplant surgery, the strategy is to take those hairs physically as units and then place them in areas where scalp, where the desire is to place hair. But when you first notice hair loss, typically you've already lost 50% of your hair. And the great injustice in your age group is that the rule of decades, basically as a rule of thumb, tells us that when you're in your 20s, about 20% of your contemporaries have hair loss. That means 80% of your contemporaries have lots and lots of hair. Now that changes. As you get into your 40s and 50s, it becomes more of a 40 to 50% of men have significant hair loss. And so it becomes more socially acceptable. But certainly in your 20s, I can understand how this is a very painful period for you, and you would want to get some kind of procedure. I've seen so many patients come to my practice who got hair transplants in their 20s, but because they weren't able to take medical therapy like Propecia, or because they didn't want to, they continue to lose hair, and when you continue to lose hair, all you see are transplants. And socially, that is nowhere near the volume that your contemporaries have. So be mindful of that before moving forward with the transplant. The values or guidelines in industry has changed a little bit since my time of training. I've seen a lot more hair transplant surgeons actually perform transplants on people who are young, who have this kind of history like yourself. And I'm actually surprised at how many of these transplants are being done, given the limitations. Unfortunately, I suspect more of a financial goal rather than the management of patients, but that's my opinion. As far as hair regeneration, we have developed in our practice a method, a procedure, where we are combining a material called extracellular matrix, which is derived from pig bladder, originally designed for wound healing, and we're combining it with platelet-rich plasma. This is platelet-rich plasma, which is derived as a byproduct from your own blood, which concentrates the growth factors. In and of itself, from my experience, platelet-rich plasma, which is commonly used in a small percentage of hair loss treating physicians, it helps hair loss, but on its own, I don't think it's sustainable in that it doesn't reverse hair thinning. What we've been able to do is literally reverse the hair thinning with our hair regeneration treatment. This is something that's been in development over several years, and we're at a point now where we can boast close to 100% success rate for male pattern hair loss. And what we're doing is we're doing a one-time injection and literally reversing the thinning of hair and basically stopping the process and thickening the hair. So for many of our patients are young men in their 20s and 30s, as well as men who have had transplants but are seeing the progression of hair loss and don't want to go for another transplant. So it's been a very exciting time, and we were featured recently in the news for this. And I think that it is important that you understand that in the field of hair loss, the one thing that we have been able to truly establish is that there's a lot that is yet to be understood about the causes of hair loss as well as the ways to reverse hair loss. For at least 30 years, several biotech companies have tried to get some kind of solution. And from my perspective, this use of extracellular matrix, which happened to be an accidental discovery, has resulted in greater benefit to patients with hair loss than the work that hundreds of millions of dollars has been invested in the goal of hair cloning or trying to grow hair in a lab and implant those hairs. I would love for this stuff to materialize because it would give me one more tool that would help surgeons like myself help people like you. But at this time, with the limitations of what is FDA approved, and the material we're using is FDA cleared for wound healing. It isn't approved specifically for hair loss at this time. But as a surgeon, as a physician, there is common to have off-label use of materials as long as it is clinically appropriate. So I think that if someone like you were to come to my office, I would recommend hair regeneration as the treatment. And we follow our patients very closely, just to give you an idea of what our process is. We see people at 1 month, 3 months, and we follow people up to 2 to 3 years. Once a patient is in my practice, the door is always open. So we have been able to establish some real efficacy. So in summary, I would like to just remind you, be mindful of the limitations and the expectations of a hair transplant procedure, and learn about this extracellular matrix technology and hair regeneration, and see if you could find a provider that would be right for you. So I hope that was helpful. I wish you the best of luck, and thank you for your question.